I don't have to present myself, I guess. Just one thing, since we provide a web application to analyze vineyard data, I think it's important to highlight that I believe at the end of the day, to make better wine, we need to be plant-centric. So this is exactly what was at the root of the results I'm going to share with you today. Amongst all the vineyard data that we are collecting, we've been trying to associate those features coming from the vineyards with some relevant sensory features directly driving the wine quality. And this was the start of my discussions with Jim Kennedy and James Campbell. And we thought, instead of focusing on mean degree of polymerization or flavors, we should really try to have maybe a different approach where we were going to analyze the structural properties of the tannin. And in order to do that, we leverage a new concept, which is the concept of activity. So activity is, in essence, the potential with which a tannin binds to saliva proteins. So activity is measured in joule because it's essentially the energy that you need to apply to the tannin to unstick it from its protein. So I'm going to speak about joules as a way to characterize the structure of the tannin. And if you want to have more data on what are the premises of this approach, here is a series of papers that basically settle the ground for this approach to be unfolded. So just to explain a little bit how this new concept is applicable already into the wine, well, there has been a few papers. I'm going to speak about Revelet in a minute, but what you got to realize is that there is evidence of a strong relationship between tannin size, so a structural consideration, and tannin activity, so something that's more related to your sensorial perception. To give you an example of direct applications, when you age a Cabernet Sauvignon in a barrel for 12 months, say a new oak, you expect to see a drop in tannin activity of approximately 3,000 joules per mole of tannins. So bear with me, in a minute I'm going to show how that translates in terms of skin tannin composition. Similarly, when you can understand how tannin activity and tannin size affect the astringency of the wine, you can derive and strategize some winemaking practices to extract the best from your skins. So, however, there is something important to highlight because there is a mismatch between adding more tannin, regardless of tannin intrinsic quality, and adding a specific sort of tannin. So in this experiment, we started with this wine, and a tannin of high activity was gradually added at higher and higher concentration. And you see that with more tannin addition into the wine, the activity of the wine increases. However, if you add a different quality of tannin, if you add a greater and a greater concentration of a tannin presenting a low activity, you have the opposite effect, as if adding more tannin was in fact decreasing the activity, so the stickiness of the wine. So it is really important because that highlights that there are some inherent properties to the tannins that are going to drive either a higher perception of astringency or lower perception of astringency. And again, we are talking of a range of variability that is within 3,000 joules per mole. So how does that actually affect the wine that was, the grapes vine, I mean, that was at the core of our questioning. But just to make sure that the idea are clear, what's already known when we speak about wine is that an increase in tannin molecular size will be associated with sensorial perceptions such as higher astringency or chalkiness of the tannins. And another very interesting point is that as more color gets incorporated into your tannin, it is also reported in the literature with a decline in astringency. So when we started to move these purely enological concepts into the vineyards, this was our hypothesis. is there possibly a relationship that links incorporation of color with some sorts of consequences on the tannin size? And this is precisely the hypothesis that this study aimed at uncovering. So in a nutshell, there were three goals that we were trying to uncover. First, what is the dynamic of tannin size, pigmented tannins, and tannin activity over time? Because we see that tannin activity can increase or decrease while wine is aging, but how about the fruit? And also because we had an opportunity to deploy this approach over a very large variety of sites, we wanted to use contrasting sites in order to highlight how regional specificities were affecting the flavonoid composition of the wines. And that's exactly why I applied to this congress. And at the same time, we still are trying to understand what are the relationships existing between environmental factors, so we can monitor through the weather station the impact of environmental stresses, but combining that with continuous monitoring of vine water use on an infra-hourly basis. So the idea is to understand if there is a relationship that's more bearing the footprint of vine water use or more the footprint of climatic stresses. So with this context in mind, here is our experimental design. So there were 32 wineries participating. There were actually 75 sites, but for the scope of this study, I only focus into Napa Valley. So we deployed the following approach over 66 vineyards. And you see, we really try to cover the distinct American vineyard appellation, so the AVA, so that we were going to scatter the extent of the differences we are going to monitor. And at each yellow dot, we had the following experimental process where we selected a rectangle shape of 100 vines. And the blue dots at the centers are the vines that not only were contributing through their fruit to assessing how maturity kinetics was evolving with time, but we were also monitoring on those two plants the sap flow. So as water goes from the roots and then get vaporized at the leaf-air interface, we can actually monitor how much heat is being displaced, and from that, by the flow of water, and from that calculate actually how much water the vine is being using. So that's for the first part. And then at the berry level part, we run all the very classic analysis to characterize berry anatomy and primary metabolites. But then systematically after each set, we macerate into a 16% volume solution the fruit to understand a little bit how much flavonoids could be extracted into the wine-like solution. And I'm going to discuss what we observed in terms of total anthocyanins and tannins. So as far as creating a large shift in terms of environmental stresses, you can see, as was discussed earlier, that we made our point. When you look at the valley floor under a hot day like September 9th, you see that the diurnal shift between the highest maximum value and the lowest minimum value is almost 30 degrees Celsius. As opposed to what we see on the higher elevation sites within Napa Valley, where basically the diurnal shift is only of 15 degrees, while extremes are lowered. So minimum temperature are less low, and higher temperature are less high. Similarly, if we focus on only the mountain sites, you can see that through different farming strategies, we can have either a vine here in green that suffers no water deficit. These indices here translate into the level of vine water needs satisfaction. You can see that actually here the vineyard manager overdo it, since we observe a plant that transpires even more than what it could do if it wasn't responding to heat waves. And at the same time, on those high elevation sites, we also had an opportunity to monitor vineyards where the level of vine water deficit was much more pronounced, particularly during the last part of the season. So you see, we really had a large scattering contrasted situations. And at this point, it was important to highlight what variations we were going to take into account. And it's a fairly integrative strategy, since you see that regarding soil properties, planting density, vineyard age, all of that is embedded within the vine water use measurements, and the climate is coming from the weather stations. However, to be fair, we did not monitor nitrogen content, and we did not monitor disease pressure, even if it seems that there were no visual symptoms. But in an ideal world, I'd like to also understand how the footprint of nitrogen is affecting the results. So that's for the environmental / plant physiological context. Now, let's look at the results at the fruit level. So what I'm going to display on the horizontal axis is the amount of pigmented tannin. And what we are going to see on the vertical axis is the amount of color, monomeric anthocyanins. And that's important because that's our entry level as a vineyard manager to have some practices that will lead to some enological traits of the wine. By manipulating light regime, cluster thinning, we are going to manipulate monomeric anthocyanin. And here is what we've observed. You see that as more color gets synthesized and accumulated, we also observe that more tannins get pigmented. It's expected, but what was maybe not so expected was the strength of this relationship. So you get the gist. More color, more pigmented tannin. So from now on, I'm going to focus on how the amount of pigmented tannin responds to the structure of the tannin. So this is the second result. Now I'm going to share with you how color incorporation, going from low to high, responds to overall tannin size. And as was demonstrated into the wine, smaller tannins meaning lower activity, we observed exactly the same all along the season as tannin size gets smaller and smaller. So as tannin incorporates color, it looks like the size of the tannin gets reduced. So bear in mind that I am not contradicting Stefano Conduras, that he demonstrated that, he showed that the work demonstrates that with more time, there is a higher degree of polymerization. I'm just saying that within those higher degree of polymerization tannins, the distribution of the tannin size is on average getting smaller and smaller. And that leads to the take-home number one. As tannin gets color incorporated onto them, tannin size is decreasing. So that's very important in order to track the maturity. Now, let's see if what has been observed in the wine is also observed at the fruit level. Do we see a relationship between tannin size and tannin activity? So the blue line shows how the tannin size distribution gets smaller and smaller as the season unfolds. And you see in orange that activity shows that as those tannin sizes are decreasing, those tannins are also becoming less dry. Which leads to the take-home number two. As we've seen, was already demonstrated in the wine, the lower the molecular mass, the less coarse is the tannin. Or in more prosaic terms, as the size of the tannin decreases, the activity of the tannin decreases. So the conclusions are that tannin size decreases as more color gets incorporated, which leads to an increase of pigmented tannin. And since activity and size are correlated, well, that's what I meant by 1 + 2. The idea is that when you are monitoring pigmented tannin, or the coloration basically, you're also getting some insight into the lower tannin size with its consequences in terms of astringency and activity. In other words, that will be my take-home number three. Monitoring color is useful, and it's not only useful for color. You can infer what is going to mean in terms of the structure of the tannin. So in order to illustrate this point, I am going to basically share with you the main trends that have been highlighted following the PCA. We run tons of PCA because we looked at global radiations, vine water use, also the sequences of when the water use starts to happen. So instead of flooding you with tons of PCA, I'd rather summarize the main conclusions we've gained so far. And it seems that there is a decoupling of the footprint of environmental stresses from the footprint of vine water use stresses. When we focus on the impact of vine water deficit variations, it seems to affect, number one, the onset of sugar accumulation. More stress means an earlier start of active sugar accumulation, which is also attached to an earlier start of coloration. When we look at site-to-site variations, regardless of the vine water use, it seems that some specific traits of the sites, probably linked to the environmental conditions, affected the rate of pigmented tannin, their size, and activities. So what does that mean in concrete terms? Well, if I look back to my first slides where I was showing within Napa that we were going to compare high elevation sites on the top of the ridges of the Napa Valley and valley floor data. And this is what we get. So looking at two appellations in the mountain sites, you see, as expected, since the maximum temperatures are less high, we are observing that the mean anthocyanin distribution, so the standard deviation results from the fact that behind each plot, there is anywhere from 6 to 12 sites. You see that where we have a mountainside location, we have more color. As expected, on mountain sites location, we have more pigmented tannins where we add more color. If I keep going, well, where we have more color incorporated, we also see that the trend points towards an average distribution of tannin size that's lower. And last, we also see that the trend with those lower tannin size is to go towards decline in activity just pre-harvest. And you see that the range of variations is similar to the range of variations we impose through winemaking techniques in the cellar. So what I'm trying to suggest here is that there is now a lot of opportunities for winemakers to start making their winemaking decisions into the field by understanding the causalities linking vineyards operation, environmental stresses, and their consequences in the structure of the flavonoids of the berries. Thank you. So in summary, there were two sorts of learnings. One, theoretical learnings, which is pigmented tannin are correlated with monomeric anthocyanins. Pigmented tannin increases as tannin size decreases, and tannin size and tannin pigmentation goes along and affects tannin activity. The practical learnings of those results is that in the future, it's very likely that understanding how the kinetics of pigmented tannin is happening in different sites and in response to different practices will give the winemaker some new tools to manage tannin perception even before the fruit is being harvested. Thank you.